Good evening and welcome to The Pinken Show live as Darren Eadie slurps his tea. This is your hour of dedicated Norwich City programming that scores a brace of own goals on a weekly basis. We are live right now on YouTube and on Muster TV in Norwich to round up all the latest Canaries talking points, get your views in talkies cheap, and look ahead to the penultimate weekend of the season as Norwich City do their bit for working relations by popping up to their feeder club. Here in the studio alongside me, with fingers crossed, the Wi-Fi hamsters turn their wheels long enough to keep us broadcasting. Ah, Sky Sports Alec Neil understudy, Darren Eadie. Oh. Yes! And friend of the show, sports journalist Stuart Hodge. At least you didn't spit out your tea this time.
Why did I not get a ka-ching noise? Just wondering.
I don't know. We haven't paid you, Stuart. I think that's the problem. Oh, but next time. And as I've mentioned, and you will most certainly find out over the next hour, we are live tonight, so you can get in touch with us right here in the studio. Yes, you. All you need to do to get through to this very phone is post your comments and questions in the live chat on the YouTube feed. Send your tweets, including the handle. That was yesterday. at Pinken.
We're live.
Or give us a bell. The number is 01603-63-0006.
Post your tweets.
Simple. Let's get things going with this week's headlines. You shall be released. That's definitely a song. That is definitely, I just don't know how it goes. And let's face it, we're all wondering about next season rather than this at the moment. Step forward sporting director Stuart Webber, who is getting busy with it, suggesting only half the city's current squad will survive the summer. Someone set fire to the deadwood. So you've got two up your sleeve, Stu. Definitely works. More Webber now, who, as we know, is drawing up a two-man shortlist for City's new head coach. Uwe Rosler's Fleetwood may miss out on automatic promotion and have to face the League One playoffs, while Gary Monk's Leeds are in danger of dropping out of the Championship postseason picture altogether, and he's yet to get a deal for next season. I'm not saying it's those two, obviously. Pritchard nails an A in woodwork. Yes. For a side looking forward to the Premier League, the Brighton fans were still rather obsessed with missing out on signing Alex Pritchard in the summer. Never mind, hey. Let's just hope they don't scrape enough money together to prize the little man out of City's hands. Between that and Chris Hughton's Carrow Road return, it was a good old feisty Friday night and a decent win too. The party's moving on for Kyle. Remember him? City actually have an option to extend Kyle Lafferty's contract for one more season. No. Mm. Even the man himself knows he won't be staying and has now said as much on the record. What a wacky 3 years he has had here. Still, it's been worth every penny. Well, for Kyle, anyway. And finally, name your top dog. Route 1. Thursday is deadline day for your Norwich City Player of the Season votes, and sure, it's not been the best of campaigns, but most fans will have an opinion on their top performer. So get your votes in, and this from the writer who sat on the fence entirely when he wrote about this year's Player of the Season award in his column last week. Good luck! There we go. Darren and Stuart, welcome to the show. Good evening. How are we?
Very good.
Yeah, all right.
It's all right. It's all right. So, Stuart, it's nice to see you in the studio, because normally we're sort of camped outside Carrow Road after a match.
Do you know what? I felt I should probably bring my jacket with me, but then I kind of reassessed it. I thought it was a bit too warm.
Did you normally spend the night there? Do you camping?
What, at the car park?
Yeah.
Well, if you've seen that jacket, it probably looks like.
No comment at all. So it's been quite the week, hasn't it? We obviously had the Brighton game, which we'll get stuck into, but it kind of feels like it's all been dominated by Stuart Webber getting his feet under the table as sporting director.
And rightly so. And I think one thing that has been labelled at the football club in recent months is there's been too much silence. And there's certainly not that now at the moment. There's lots coming out of Carrow Road. Still lots more to come out of Carrow Road. And everything he's saying, I'm really excited by. I have to say, I think he's saying all the right things. Doesn't mean it's going to bring success, of course, but I think that it is exciting me to think that there is a kind of clean sweep of players going in and out. Changing of backroom staff, new manager, a fresh look to the football club and an identity. That's the big thing he's talking about.
Yeah, that's
his football
key word
identity.
It's fresh. I think there's a new energy about the club at the moment, and I think that's what I think you just feel that change is afoot. And after a campaign like this that's been so frustrating, but where there have been flashes of what it could have been, really, That's what you need. You need that freshness, that impetus. The one thing I would say about Weber is talk is cheap. And he's seen quite
thanks,
a lot. He's seen quite a lot. So on that basis, he's basically sort of making a rod for his own back in a sense, because he's now putting himself in a situation where there's pressure to deliver.
He's massively putting himself in the firing line, because he's just everything he's saying it's basically what I want to create. I mean, yep. Even the identity, that's totally. Almost down to him. He wants to say, I want to create the identity for the football club. Whether it's the right one for Norwich or not, we don't know. But if it is anything to go by looking at Huddersfield, that's the kind of football style we're used to seeing at Carrow Road. So obviously he wants to get a good look at the team to feel the atmosphere in the Carrow Road and look probably at some history in Norwich of how they've played. So, you know, it's down to his identity. He's going to be choosing that manager that fits with his identity. Mm. So all of a sudden, all this, the building of the football squad and the team is not coming down to a manager. It's coming down to someone above, and that's huge amounts of pressure on
him. Absolutely. We'll get stuck into the numbers and how it deals with the atmosphere at Carrow Road too. I did want to touch on the Brighton win, because Alex Pritchard, I think he's a joy to watch at the moment. I mean, how would you have felt had you have had that performance, hit the woodwork twice and not been able to claim a goal or even an assist?
Yeah, you still claim it, I would. Oh, well, no, you can't officially have it, but there. But he's buzzing because it's both his goals. That's what I'd be like, even if they come off the goalkeeper, they're mine. That's what I'd be like.
Yeah.
But to be fair, I mean, it was a good performance, I have to say, but I think Brighton had their flip-flops on already for the summer, on the beach, had a few beers, nice and relaxed, were that bothered. But again, for me, it's more of a frustration of where Norwich could have been, could have been.
Yeah, no, totally. I think the Reading game was a big one for me, because they're probably going to squeak into the playoffs. Don't get me wrong, I don't think there's any chance that they're going to go up. They'll be one of the poorest teams I've seen in the Championship playoffs in a long time, actually, I think, because they seem to me to be very one-dimensional. And we absolutely schooled them, which just shows.
But even Brighton, you think they're promoted and how comfortable
they've
been.
Well, I think Brighton might be your classic case of a side built to go up. Mm. When they get there, it might be a lot harder. Mm. And now, as always, the Pinker match day was at Carrow Road on Friday night to catch up with Pritchard, Irvine, Hughton and the City faithful following their Brighton win. Here are some of the best bits.
I thought we controlled the game for most of the time. I thought that we defended well when we were out of possession, and I thought that we passed the ball well for most of the game. I thought maybe second half we were a bit wasteful with some passes when we got into that final third, but I think overall it was a very good performance.
I think over the 90 minutes, I think that Norwich were better than us. I thought they used the ball better than us over the 90 minutes, but it's certainly strange to lose a game when Norwich in effect have had no shots on target. Very unusual, and certainly I've not seen that before.
You can't blame him for that stuff, so he goes down to two goals for him,
I feel a little bit for him, but you know whether it's a Pritchard or a Naismith or a Houlihan, I think if you there's good players here, and when you allow them that opportunity to strike in front of goal, then you know, you're asking for trouble. So probably that's more of the disappointment. No blame at all on David Stockdale, but we can't allow, as I say, that you know, quality of player to strike the ball without challenging at that time.
Yeah, it doesn't happen that often, does it? Yeah. And I'm surprised at that, actually. For all that I've just said, that we were a bit wasteful, I thought that we would actually have hit the target. Whether you count hitting the frame of the target as hitting the target or not, I don't know. Some people will and some won't. I thought that we had to defend a lot of crosses, because they're good at that. They've got real threats in wide areas, players who can manipulate enough space for themselves to deliver good crosses into the box. It was one of the things we spoke about, you know, that would be an area where we would have to be good. And I felt that we were. You know, they didn't win much in our box that was thrown in there.
I mean, obviously, it's been an emotional week for everybody around the club. But you hope that everybody has settled down for that period, and obviously that's what I saw, and that was all of the talk before the game. So how much the performance, the overall performance, how much of that is down to the emotions of the week, or just down to an off day for us? And because, you know, we've had days like this before, and if the goals don't go in, then we're still in the game. We're still in the game, and we've certainly been able at times to turn a performance round into a better performance. But, you know, when you're 2-0 down here, it's very difficult to get back from that. So, yes, it's been an emotional week. How much of it is down to that, I don't know. But we certainly weren't at our level today.
No, it was a good occasion. Obviously, they've come here. They needed to win the league, but we owe them one. Beating us 5-0 at their place, so we've come here 2-0, good performance, and we go again next week.
Yeah, was that result back in October in the back of the players' mind today?
Yeah, I think I said it, a few others said it, like, they beat us 5-0. They gave us a thumping, and we owed them one tonight, and we did. No, I just take it. It was good banter. It is what it is, and fair play to Brighton. They've been amazing this season. They deserve it.
Yeah, where do you stand on that? Because I guess you could have been a Brighton player, as they kept telling you. I mean, how do you feel about that at this moment in time?
It's just a decision. You live with it, you move on, and we'll get promoted next year, hopefully.
And the Pinker Matchday returns one more time this season when City round off their season at home to QPR on Sunday week. We're properly in the business end of the season now, so let's catch up on the Championship picture. Leeds, Huddersfield and Reading all hit the buffers, while Ipswich will be the only side this season that has failed to beat already relegated Rotherham. I didn't mean to laugh then. Fulham, yes I did, and Sheffield Wednesday look in decent form, while Burton effectively secured their safety with that Leeds win, and Wigan put off their relegation with their goalless draw. On Monday, Newcastle joined Brighton in confirming their automatic promotion, while on Tuesday, Huddersfield win at Molineux booked the Terriers' place in the playoffs. So, Wigan are on the brink, while Birmingham's defeat at Villa mean Harry Redknapp is going to have a nervous finish to the season. QPR are realistically the highest side that is still fearing the bottom three, while Ipswich are extremely unlikely, there they are, to earn a top-half finish. Am I being booed or Ipswich? I'm not sure which. As for the top, at the summit, the top two are promoted and Brighton remain one win away from the title. The only team in danger of threatening the top six party is Leeds. Those hopes could be extinguished by City at Elland Road on Saturday. Norwich could yet break through the 70-point mark this season, which is kind of the frustration, isn't it? And I think you've said it for a little while that Norwich would probably miss out, not by much. It's not going to be much in it, is there?
No, there's been a lot of teams that have been in and around it this season. I think the playoffs has been quite a high total in terms of lots of teams been in and around that amount. But it just frustrates me to be 10 points adrift with some really shocking results in there and some really brilliant results in there. So that's the frustration, I think, for me. But they're more than capable of going to begin next season. No, and it's got to be for me.
Well, absolutely. Newcastle confirming their promotion. It's been a slightly interesting day with them and West Ham being implicated in various tax fraud allegations, which we won't get stuck into. But promotion, I mean, had to happen, didn't it?
I think Rafa Benitez will be disappointed that, because I think in all likelihood Brighton are going to go on and confirm things. I think he'll be disappointed not to win the league. However, I think next season they're going to do better.
Well, we will see. Okay, that is part one done. We're heading for a break on Mustard. And if you're watching on YouTube, you're about to get some bonus studio time. On the other side, we will turn the show over to you as we take your calls, comments and questions in Talk is Cheap. We will see you in three. Look at that! Yay. Hello, YouTube. We're back. Should we open it up on?
We think we're on.
Talk into that one? This is like bonus stuff. Bear in mind that someone needs to go to the toilet in a break, they will go.
I'll just do it here. Someone go anywhere.
That's what that lead is. The one comment we've had on the YouTube feed. Get your comments and questions in, by the way. And we'll mention this later, of course. But from a stunning array of, did you put that shirt on a hot wash by mistake, Darren? A bit harsh, I quite like that.
What are you trying to say? Is it too small or...?
I think it's the fading.
The faded bit in it.
With the white, with the red paint.
But do you know
spots.
What? In life, there's shepherds and there's sheep.
Which are you, Darren?
Some people are fashion leaders, aren't they? And some people follow.
I am a follower. I don't need to know about
dedicated
all that stuff.
Dedicated follower of fashion.
I don't know. Many wouldn't say that. But no one's given me any stick for my beard, so I'm
That's a nice bit. It's a good beard. You've got no grey in it.
That's not true. There are a couple of grey hairs.
I'm quite impressed by the fact you've got beard oil. That's commitment.
I do, yeah. It's quite expensive, though, beard oil. Mm. And you have to use it quite sparingly.
Are we having this conversation?
Well, this is all the gold people are going to get on YouTube. Man points. There was so much I wanted to talk about. We didn't get to talk about it. I'm getting a lot of stick in my ear for mentioning beard oil, by the way. I hadn't bought any until the other day. Very exciting.
I'll tell you what I'll talk about. For you guys being in journalism, the season finishes,
yes.
What do you go and do?
Holidays.
Do you literally have the time for the rest of the season off?
He works a lot harder than me.
Well, it's not that. My holidays are dictated by my family, so that's an issue.
But potentially you could have the whole of the season, end of the season off if you want to. Yeah.
Are we going back? Are we coming back? That's it. Cool, that was worth it.
Ooh. Cool. What about that comedy gold those people at home just missed?
Unbelievable.
See it on YouTube.
Unbelievable. Yeah. I'm glad you put your shirt back on. Welcome to Talk Is Cheap, where your calls, questions, comments, and posts lead our Norwich City agenda. And alongside me in the studio, I have the delectable duo of legendary Norwich City winger Darren Eadie and sports journalist Stuart Hodge. So, to get in touch with us here in the studio or this very phone, simply post your comment or question in the live chat feed on YouTube. Send us a tweet, including the handle @Pinken, which is on my other iPad, or give us a call on 01603-63006. Right, away we go then. I don't know if we already have our first caller on the line.
Wow. That was lined up, is it?
No, not at all. At least we're still on air. That's better than last week. Robson Summers, I think I heard. Robson, thank you so much for ringing in. Good to speak to you. What would you like to talk about tonight?
Hi everyone. Yeah, I just thought I'd ring just talk about the safe standing in the Barclay, which is something that a lot of people have wanted for ages. So I just want to see your point of view on it.
I guess what's fueled this a bit, Robson, in terms of your opinion, is the comments from Stuart Webber regarding the atmosphere at Carrow Road, how he's obviously just come into the club and he's felt in recent games that Carrow Road hasn't really been doing what it's supposed to be doing. Do you see the two connected?
Yeah, I do. I think it's because the stewards at Carrow Road have always tried and make people sit down in a Barclay. And that is kind of the stand, as long as the safety that want to stand up, want to sing, and try and make an atmosphere. And over the past few seasons, it's dropped massively. And I think introducing safe standing, as has been shown at Celtic, it can boost the atmosphere and make a hell of a difference.
A fist pump from Stuart there at the mention of Celtic. No surprises there. I think taking it to the... Thanks, Robson. We'll come back to you in a moment. The interesting point here is, of course, the stewards have to make people sit down because the rules of this ground are you have to sit because there's seating. It's not their fault that they're employing the rules. The problem is some fans will always want to stand.
Safe seating's been around a long time in the Bundesliga now, and the atmosphere it's created at those grounds is just incredible. I don't know the facts and figures, but I don't know if there's been any injuries or major incidences with the safe standing in the Bundesliga. So why it's not been addressed or looked at over here as yet, I really don't know, because it creates everything. And you talk about Premier League being the most exciting league in the world. You add that kind of atmosphere and the opportunity to have that as well, it's only going to make it even better. So I'm shocked it hasn't been even looked at already.
I think when you look at fans at German stadiums, they look like they're having a much better time at the football than a lot of British fans do at Premier League games. So I definitely think it's an idea that should be looked at. And kudos to Robson and some of the guys in the Barclay, because they're actually keeping the atmosphere alive at times at Carrow Road.
Does it make a difference? I mean, have you felt that the atmosphere has been a bit poor at Carrow this season?
Yeah, it has, but understandably so. I think we've all, the expectations we all had at the start of the season, and it kind of, it's a catch-22. I think that the players make the fans sing, and I think that the players start to play well if there's a good atmosphere. But, you know, I've played at one of the noisiest grounds with Newcastle played at. Just the noise is phenomenal the whole time. And when you're actually on the pitch as a player, you can't hear anything. So sometimes it can be a bit of a hindrance. So actually, yeah, a quiet Carrow Road is sometimes quite good because you can hear your other players shouting and calling for the ball and stuff like that. Whereas when it is intense, really, really loud and intense, you can't hear anything.
And Carrow Road can do that when it's going for them.
Yeah.
We've had them do it before, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I can remember the game at the end of last season against Watford, and I was blown away. I thought, this is absolutely brilliant. Team going down, bit of gallows humour.
Ipswich Town were coming for you, that kind of thing. And I thought, do you know what, this is going to be great. I'm going to go along next season and going to be entertained by an atmosphere like that. And don't get me wrong, it's easier under the lights, of course. But I've been disappointed by the atmosphere this season on many occasions.
But also as well, as a player, you know, again, this comes down to the types of personalities I think the squad has had and, well, probably not had. You learn to deal with that as a player anyway. Yeah. And I think it's something the top professionals and the good players you get, doesn't matter what atmosphere you got, they still play the game and do their job. Whereas I think that perhaps some of the players that have been in the squad have been affected by that.
Yeah, it was interesting. Stuart Webber mentioned Jacob Murphy and the way he sort of got ridiculed for one shot that hit the corner
flag.
I think it was shocking. They were both shocking. But Jacob was kind of grown up enough to. Yeah. He scored later in that game and dealt with it really well. Robson, turning back to you then, I get the sense there's a core of Norwich fans that agree with this and really want to lift the atmosphere and will probably take it upon themselves to do that next season. Do you feel that's where, but that's obviously what the reaction Stuart Webber would want, rather than people complaining that he doesn't understand the club or things like that.
I think, yeah, there is a load of Norwich fans that do want the atmosphere. The problem is there's people in the park who do want to sit down, don't want to create the atmosphere, and there's people who want to make an atmosphere, but in the NMP stand, which just isn't working at all. I think you need to make a singing or vocal section, which the Barkley lower blocky is kind of is. Put all the people who want to sing within the Barkley and people who don't want to sing in the stand, move them into maybe the NMP or the South stand.
Whoa. It is an interesting point where people do kind of put themselves within the crowd. I think in Norwich, once somebody's got their seat, they think, well, that's it, right, I'm here for 20 years. But I think it is interesting that other clubs tend to find areas where they're, you know, you've got the Kop classically at yep. Liverpool. Doesn't seem to have that so much at Norwich. It does need to be a designated area where the safe stand. But I don't know if a club like Norwich can force that issue. I mean, how can they make these things come along? Can they make safe standing for Norwich? Can any team, if they want it, can they make it happen? Or do they have to go for
I think we're not at that stage yet, because there are rules that prevent teams in the top two tiers having... Even Burton, who have tiers at the Pirelli Stadium, will need to upgrade their stadium over season or two now they're in the Championship, so they've got to make those changes. Thanks very much, Robson, for your call, by the way. Great stuff. And do you get the impression at Celtic there's been a difference in the atmosphere from having that? Your Celtic context?
Well, let's be honest, it's one of the best atmospheres in world football anyway, especially in European nights.
Given.
But
only when you play one game against Rangers. See
the games against the
This might be the end of it now, by the way.
And Aberdeen and that kind of thing. Because you've got that section that are carrying the atmosphere, because it's not the same at those kind of league games, but you've now got that standing section, they do what we call the huddle, where they turn their backs, they paint themselves, they do all sorts, and it just adds, it's almost like a carnival-esque atmosphere.
Yeah, and that does make a big impression. It's a difficult subject to talk about, because we know the connotations of Hillsborough and those things, but I don't know if we're in a slightly different position with everything that's come out over Hillsborough in recent years, that it makes the debate, it's worth having the debate again, most definitely. Now, I think we've got a tweet, and I believe it's from Ewan Wilson, not Roberts, but he says, Stuart Webber is exactly right about atmosphere. Try to make noise in the South Stand and you just get dodgy looks off people. It needs to change. Happens in the City Stand in front of the press box as well, I can show you.
But that to me again is down to where the people are positioning themselves. It's not so much that they're getting told off by stewards, because you can make as much noise as you like, as long as it's not profanities. You can shout, you can scream, you can do what you like. But the problem is you're getting people who are just coming to watch the game and have had their season ticket for 20 years and are going to sit there. To next to someone who's probably had a season ticket for a season who wants to make a lot of noise.
Which is an issue at Carrow Road, isn't it? Because that almost needs freshening up. Is that fair to say? I mean, you can't obviously just move fans on.
Of course.
People have their seat, like you said, for a period of time, and that's an interesting
It'd be interesting to find out if almost the seating arrangements could be rearranged. So you have a designated area, say, look, this is where we're going to have these people singing. If you don't want to sit there, you could perhaps can move to somewhere else in the stadium. We've got the seat for you, just swapping seats.
Logistically, it's going to be quite problematic to try and implement. But the key thing for me is I think it's a cultural thing. Mm. Some people go to football, in Spain, for example, the culture is very much, you go to the football to be entertained. In Germany, it's very much you get behind the team. It seems like Norwich have both of those kind of schools of thought in terms of the support.
And they're clashing, bang in the middle of the Gerald stand. Mm. Right, we've got our next call on the line, which is Sam Walden, I think. Sam, thank you so much for ringing. Good to hear from you again. Would you like to talk about the atmosphere, or would you like to talk about something else?
Well, I'm happy to talk about the atmosphere, but my main call was with the season coming to an end, was the player of the season.
Go for it, Sam. Do you want to cast your vote now, live on air?
Yeah, I think for this season, it's obviously been very disappointing. But I think, and he has been here a while, and I think Wes should have won it a couple of times before, but he had good competition up against him with Grant Holt and Bradley Johnson in 14-15. And I think Wes has proved time and time again this season that he's still got it at 34. And every game he plays in, and we win big or he does stuff, everyone always points out how good he has been and how he's still got it at 34 years old.
Just taking it back to you then, Sam, do you want to give us your top three? Because I sense, and I kind of wrote this myself, you give Wes player of the season, not for this season, but for his what he's done over his time here. If there's a specific someone who's really put it in this season, it might be a different vote. So what would be your top three?
For me this season, Wes is both sentimental and for this season as well. I think, obviously, he's not going to play as many games, but in the games he has played, he's proved time and time again that he's still got it. You know, I mean, I think I watched the Brighton game last week, and I think Alex Pritchard, had he played more, would have been hands down the winner, but obviously he hasn't played enough. But my top three would be Wes, Jerome and Jacob Murphy.
Great stuff, Sam. Yeah, hold the line. We'll come back to you. That's the top three.
I would agree with the sentiment view on Wes Houlihan. I think in a season where nobody's really shone out brightly enough, I think to warrant being called player of the season on an obvious pick, I would go with Wes purely on the sentiment. But, and he has played well as well. So I think those two mixed together, I think he would deserve it. But, you know, Johnny House, I think, has had a great season.
Ivo Pinto, Cameron Jerome, I think, definitely.
Yeah, it's but that's when, again, you're talking about four or five players that have all done all right and played quite well, whereas normally your standout player does shine, and we haven't really had one of those this season.
Stuart?
I think just for, like, scored a few amazing goals as well, and the consistency of his play, box to box, my vote would go to Johnny Howson. I can definitely see the sentiment with Wes. There's certainly an argument for that. Also a bit of sentiment with Jacob Murphy. One of our own, he's come through, and he's really seized his opportunity this season. And I think particularly the fact that Josh was always the one that was really heralded as special. He was obviously on loan at a high level last season, but Jacob's taken the bull by the horns this season and really seized his opportunity. So that's good. And just for the dynamism of his play, I would also say that Ivo Pinto was worth a shout, because I just think he adds a whole new dimension to Norwich City.
They don't win when he doesn't play, generally, or certainly lose anyway. Sam, very briefly back to you. We haven't got long with you, I'm afraid. But in terms of head coach, I know you've spoken about it before. Who do you want?
Well, I would really like Gary Monk to come in. I think he's done a fantastic job at Leeds, even though they have slipped out the playoffs. Not many managers do well there, and not many managers last the whole season sometimes there. But if we were to get another outsider, I quite like the look of Paul Clement at Swansea. But whether he would leave them or be sacked if they go down is a different matter. I think he's a good up-and-coming coach, and I think he was doing well at Derby before he was surprisingly sacked. And he's obviously worked with some of the best coaches around.
Stuff, Sam. Thanks so much for your call. I guess a lot of that would depend on which divisions Swansea were playing in next year, of course. I just get through some posts on the live chat on the YouTube. You can, you know, get through to us. It's straight in the studio if you fancy it. One here. Where was it? I did just want to find it from Stunning Array Of. We mentioned it in the break. Did you put that shirt on a hot wash by mistake, Darren? Was it funnier the second time?
No.
There you go. The official confirmation there. Lewis Moffitt. I think we need an experienced manager now. Hughton, Adams, Neil all didn't have any Premier League experience. We need someone now who knows what they're doing.
We're not in the Premier League.
Championship experience enough. Yeah, but Do you think it'll be someone who has managed in the Championship?
No. I think it's going to go one of two ways. I think it's is Gary Monk, I think, I would like, because I think he's got experience in Premier League and Championship, and I like the way he works. Rosler, I'm not so sure about. He's been a bit up and down in his career. I'm not quite so keen on him. So I'd either like to see someone like Gary Monk, or to go completely left field, and as they got Wagner from someone from a big European side who's an understudy. Because, you know, that's how those clubs run, how the structure at Norwich has been put together now. So they would understand that a lot quicker than probably someone who's an experienced Championship manager.
You're absolutely right. And it's got to do with what the manager feels they've got the power over. because in British football there's a lot of, well, will I have the say on this? Will I be called a manager or a head coach? All of that kind of confusion. If you go to the continent, that model is the model that is readily used.
Indeed, indeed. Stephen Langdale says, it's Gary Monk. So there we go, that's good confirmation. Okay. We will see. And Sam Naylor, Johnny Howson, player of the season, easily, he says. Now, the other element we wanted to get discussions on is the 15. Stuart Webber saying that out of the squad on the back of the programme on Friday, Norwich City will have 12 to 15 players that will still be here next season. Now, you know, grandiose description.
And how big was the squad on the back of the programme?
28 players.
So basically
and,
half.
You could whip off 12 quite easily, although, of course, it's sometimes easy for you to whip off 12 and a bit harder for the club to get rid of them. But we also had a great poll on pinken.com today so that you guys could pick the 15 you definitely wanted to keep. And I think we've got a little look at the 15 I picked. So there we go.
This is your picks, is it?
I'm literally being hung out to dry here. And you'll have to work out yourselves which ones I've missed out. I'm happy to stand up for any of these, but what do you guys make of that list? Who's missing? Anyone missing that you fear?
The only ones I mean, as much as I love Cameron Jerome, I think if you're talking about new eras and new changes, I think he was still going and have a decent career and get a club somewhere else. But I think he needs freshening up. I'm also not hugely still impressed with Oliveira. I know he's done scored a few goals, but really? I'm not convinced. And Wilshere, I mean, we haven't seen enough of him. Perhaps he's a Pritchard in the waiting, and hopefully he's going to get his opportunity and do well. But again, it's all well and good saying this, you know, but you've got to shift them. The reason I see you've got Russell Martin on there, and the reason I think Russell Martin would stay is because he'd be a great link between the squad and the new management team that comes in. I think just having that role.
Some fans won't be happy with that, though, will they? We've already seen it in comments made by people that they just want Russell out. Which, you know, football's a game of opinions. I mean, Damo 1642 asks, should Will Naismith be at the club next season? I mean, I think with Stephen Naismith, he'd probably like it, but he's on a lot of money. It's going to possibly be the same with players like Alex Pritchard, because if someone offers a lot of money, you've got James Maddison there, you've got to opt, and then you can spend that money elsewhere.
Pritchard,
it's a big rebuild job.
Pritchard, I've liked since he came here, and I couldn't understand why he never got the opportunity. Without a doubt, I'd like to see the squad built around him. And he's that type of player, I think, as well, that needs to play every single week and be told he's brilliant. He's just got that kind of edge about him. Naismith, I'm not bothered really if he goes or stays. He's not done enough for me, I think, consistently to warrant say, we've got to keep hold of him.
I think there's a player there that could be very valuable for Norwich City, but we've just not seen enough of him.
And sometimes it just doesn't work out for you like that. And I just perhaps, maybe it's the system, maybe it's the style of play.
Not a good fit, do you think?
Yeah, perhaps it's just the style of play. And if Stuart Webber's talking about new identity, then perhaps that might suit Naismith a little bit better.
This is the key thing, isn't it? We're going to change a lot of players. They're going to need to be able to step up to the new system and philosophy as well. Now, we've got our third caller on the line, I believe, which is Phil Burrows. Phil, thank you so much for ringing in, taking the time. We really appreciate it. The floor is yours.
I just want to say about the people saying on Twitter earlier about the bar. Can you step up to make the atmosphere?
Go for it.
Stadium that needs to stand up and sing, not just one section. You go to the likes of Germany, everyone's there to support the team.
This is a great debate because I've been going to Carrow Road since, you know, the late 80s. You've played there a long time. The whole of Carrow Road has never really, it's not ever really been that sort of ground. It doesn't happen at other places. Some it does, and Carrow Road's not really been one of those. I don't know how you get around it.
I even remember as a player, you know, often going to places and people saying, no, you know, you're Darren Eadie's here, but I don't watch that much football. So you get that, there's that kind of thing in Norfolk. It's not. And probably the fans wouldn't appreciate it. It's not a hardcore football city. It's people love to watch their football, but it's
not
more
in
of
that
a,
way, I suppose.
Yeah, it's but more of a, it's more of an event. It's more of a, they like to support their team, but they like to do it nicely.
But they do care so much. There is so much passion here.
But there's passion, but they're quite reserved people in Norfolk. Generally, they are, and I think it's just the way that the mentality of the people here.
Phil, have you got an idea how they can solve this? Because again, I saw the debate on Twitter, and people were saying, well, we look to the Barclay to kind of start the atmosphere, and then we'll get involved. And I guess the whole thing needs the club to be going well anyway. But what do you do about it? Have you got a plan?
The general problem is a lot of people have come in their few years now. A lot of people have come over, go, I've come here for the atmosphere, but don't contribute to the atmosphere at all. So they've come to be close, not realising they've got to be in the atmosphere to make it.
Thanks so much for your call, Phil. That's brilliant.
I think that's a really good point, because in the Bundesliga, win, lose or draw, their fans go for the atmosphere and have a good time and almost have routines of what they do in their sections.
Yeah.
So it's about that rather than, you know, if their team win, of course they want their team to win, but it's about the whole day and actually providing that atmosphere as an excitement and as something to do.
And I get the sense when Stuart Webber has his feet under the table and next time they put out, you know, season ticket renewal forms, they're going to make the point of everyone being a part of the atmosphere and maybe taking on their responsibility a little bit, which is kind of what has happened at Huddersfield.
You can lead a horse to water, can't you?
Yeah, see, that's the thing. You can't manufacture this. It's got to be done organically. The fans have actually... It's almost like a sort of mass uprising against the government or something. There's got to be a consensus among the people to do it. It's not something you can manufacture. Is there anything worse than when you go to a concert and you see them doing that thing where they get the people to clap?
It's but just, it works, it's, Stuart. It works.
No, but it's so Everyone forced. Claps. It's so forced. Whereas if you actually have the fans generating that themselves, that's the key to it. I mean, the thing for me is when I used to go to the football when I was younger, part of the joy of going was that participatory element. You were actually contributing to the atmosphere, yeah, and you felt part of something bigger. Mm. And I don't get the sense that that happens, at least in that way, at Carrow Road.
Well, I think Norwich is it's a city that, and a lot of football clubs like it, the atmosphere is better sometimes, louder, certainly, when the team's not doing well. That's when it gets really loud. And actually, when things are going pretty well, everybody's quite content and sitting there and enjoying it.
Also, there's nothing, sorry, just that gets a football crowd behind their team more than when they feel that the referee or someone else has done them an injustice.
Exactly, yeah. Or an identity, a style
an
of
identity.
Play.
And it'll come down to results.
No, I have to be, it's not been too pretty to watch, has it?
I've been to Newcastle a lot of times. The atmosphere's always been rubbish when I've been, but yeah, maybe that was a Norwich thing, I don't know. We've got our fourth caller on the line. I don't think we've got too long, but it is David, and he's definitely not angry as far as I know. Good to speak to you, David. What would you like to talk about tonight?
Hello, Michael. Yeah, going on about the atmosphere at the ground, I don't think the atmosphere has been great for about three or four seasons, if not more than that, to be honest with you.
What are you going to do about it then, David? This is the key. I know that it's instigated by what happens on the pitch, but what would you like to see happen at Carrow Road to mean that the atmosphere is better next season?
That's a very good question, isn't it, Michael? What would you do? I don't know, Mr. Webster seems to know all the answers. I don't know, I mean, apart from have a full-scale band in the middle at half-time or something to get them rocking, I really don't know, because the bottom tier of the Barclay is absolutely dead. And also, I sit in the top tier of the Barclay, and there's people around me more interested during the game on looking on their mobile phones and looking at pictures that they've took during the week. I mean, that you go to football, watch a game of football, don't you?
You certainly do.
I think it's an interesting point. I think it would be interesting to find out what the makeup of Norwich City fans are in terms of age range, all that type of stuff. But compared to a club like Newcastle or Liverpool, it's always really noisy. The makeup of age groups and gender and everything within involved that to a really noisy crowd compared to what Norwich's is, to see if that is a difference.
This is a family club.
We've always had that. This is a family club, so you get lots of young families going along, which isn't going to be as loud atmosphere.
There's also a lot of sort of older people also go to the football here. I think, like, you obviously get diehards that have gone for years to every club. But I definitely think there is a difference in the demographic.
It's definitely an older demographic here. And because the ground's been full, they haven't been able to really refresh it, which it's kind of a bit of an issue. And I am sorry I put you on the spot with that one, David, but we've got about 30 seconds. Is it upon the Barclay to make this atmosphere and the snake pit, of course, do you think?
Partly the snake pit. I was all against safe standing, but I'm starting to swing my way around to being safe standing because of the atmosphere. And also... I mean, you've been to as many away games as I have, Michael, and so Darren's been to a few. And the home support, I mean, the away support we do see, but the home support, I mean, you can't hear some places you go to, you can't hear yourself think.
It's true indeed.
Away fans,
thank you so much,
demographic.
David. It is, and a different energy to it as well. It's a great debate. I have a feeling we're going to be touching on this again. We're done, aren't we? We'll come back to some quotes if we can, questions in part three. But that is us down for Talk is Cheap. A huge thank you for all your calls, tweets and comments. If you want to get involved in future, simply get in touch via the pinken.com message board or send an email to sport@mustardtv.co.uk. And if you want to see it all over again, you can catch every piece of our Norwich City content over on our Norfolk Now YouTube channel. That is it for part two of the Pinken Show. We're headed into another break, but if you're watching on YouTube, then stay put for some extracurricular studio chatter. And when we return, we'll bring you our latest Ballon d'Or contenders, plus our look ahead to Leeds. Don't go anywhere. We'll see you in three.
Yay!
Oh, gosh! Oh!
What a horrible sight.
That was funny, wasn't
People
it?
People could check out beard oil up. Then.
I was just trying to get on the reflection. Yeah. We're not going to talk about beard again.
So this whole safe standing thing, I know that it has to be regulations and approved and all this sort of
yeah.
stuff. And I know it's very a very kind of sensitive subject because of Hillsborough and all that, but Hillsborough is very different. You know, the fences were basically the mistake at Hillsborough at the front, and there's none of that now. So
the policing?
Even if there was, even if there was standing now, you wouldn't have a Hillsborough because there's somewhere for people to get off onto the pitch. So,
you'd have fans per seat. You'd still have allocated spaces with, say, standing.
But that nobody, like, say, Stuart, getting into a ground is different now. Everything's different. You literally have to, it's like Fort Knox trying to get into a ground with footprints and stuff like that. So you're not going to get that type of thing happen again. And if it did, if there was a massive surge and people managed to get in, because there's no fences, it's just going to spill out onto the pitch.
Exactly, the fences are a big difference. Yeah. I mean, people still launch over seats and go on the pitch. We saw it at Port Vale Bolton, I think. Yeah. At the weekend, where it all got a bit tasty, and
you're connected with all the league stuff that's going on.
I watched the Channel 5 highlights.
Especially in the Bundesliga, they have the safe standing. They do have a massive net, don't they, at the front, in front of them. So whether that can be dropped, I guess, so people can get out or whatever, I don't know. But
at Celtic, they don't feel the requirement for that. Yeah. And if anything, you would think, a sort of Scottish old firm crowd, they would potentially be more volatile than safe standing. If it was implemented at Carrow Road. My main worry about it is I think it's a good idea, but logistically, I don't see how the club can do it. I think it would be a real challenge to say to people, right, do you want to move your seat? Because you'll get people that will say, oh, you want to put a safe standing section here? I've sat there for 25 years, you know?
Yeah.
I think it would create a lot of problems.
It's worth saying, producer Jake said that they've done some similar change over at Old Trafford. Now, I can't verify that that's true. I'm relying on Jake Watson's word.
Well, they did it.
I trust him.
Well, they did it when West Ham moved to the stadium, didn't they? The London Stadium. They give the opportunity for people to repick their seats.
And they've done it here, haven't they? With what they call movers and shakers.
Yeah.
But
I don't see a problem with it, to be honest.
Do you want to be a mover and shaker? Oh,
but what does it come down to as well? If they did decide to do it and Norwich decided to do it, is that a cost to Norwich?
As in safe standing?
Yeah.
Well, I've heard different things. Someone said that because the rake would have to be different and the spaces have to be different, you can't literally take out the chairs and put in safe standing. But then I've spoken to people who know much more about it than me, and they said that's not actually true. So there was going to be quite a sizable cost from what I was told that the club were expecting, so then they changed over.
And then you asked the fans, would you want that if you'd rather put that money into buying a player?
But I don't know if that's true. It could be either way, really. Look, did we get any more questions on here? There was a good one. Let me just ask this one. Craig Matlis. Thanks, Craig. If, Darren, you were Stuart Webber, what manager would you pick?
I would go for...
I keep trying to get a name out of you. I've been trying to do it for weeks.
I would go for like a Wagner. I'll go for someone, an understudy at a big European club.
Would you definitely rule out David Wagner being Carrow Road next
year? I think one of the Clement.
Clement.
No,
we're got 5 seconds.
Well, Clement, interesting point. Even if you don't want him, interesting point.
To get your trousers on that quick.
I know. Lucky YouTube, eh? Well done. Lucky YouTube. Stuart, like that one. Welcome to the final part of tonight's Pinken Show with me, with Darren Eadie, and with Stuart Hodge. The sun is setting on our season-long slog to see if producer Jake has an ounce of goalkeeping ability in those long limbs of his. Let's see how his latest band of plucky Ballon d'Or contenders got on. Over to you, Jake.
Hello, welcome to the Pinken Show's Ballon d'Or Challenge, where today we're in Lowestoft with the Road to Pro boys. And Mickey Splane, you're looking after
these boys.
Yeah, we've got a Norwich team in blue bibs against the rest of the world.
Yeah, what we're going to do, we're going to separate them into two groups. We've got Norwich boys first, and you'll see the Lowestoft boys next week. You've seen the challenge. What do you reckon they'll be like it?
Not very good.
They've given me some goalkeeping gloves, though, which is a start, so I might be decent in goal today. We'll have to wait and see. Should we bring in our first player?
Yeah.
Who we got?
Brandon Solomon, centre mid. Very good player. Very good player.
No, you don't have to say anything, mate. In next, nice and quick.
Peter Hammond, right midfielder. Very good player.
Next. Is it going to be the same for all of them?
Miles Palmer.
What position?
No comment.
No comment. It's not nice, is it? Number four. Looks angry.
Hayden Moore, centre mid slash striker. A bit like Wayne Rooney.
Yeah, I can see that. And last but no means least, who we got? There's Keeps.
Marty Bone, best goalkeeper outside Spain.
You haven't seen me yet, have you?
Oh, yeah.
Quick prediction, what do you reckon?
Blues are winning it. They'll score two.
Super, let's go. He scored three in, what was it?
156.
156, which is a pretty decent time.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Keeps, where the hell did that come from?
Yeah, to be fair, he takes them better when he's dizzy.
Yeah, so, I was watching him spin off, there's no way he's going to hit that. Bottom bin's absolute corker. So we've got next boys next, looked after by Danny Crow. What do you reckon? Do you reckon they'll beat that? No team scored five. They seem a confident bunch.
Yeah, they'll get all five, I think. Yeah, I'm confident.
Right, you'll have to watch that next week, won't you?
The next boys are next.
The next boys are next. He's getting worse, isn't he, as a goalkeeper?
Honestly.
I was hoping he'd like.
That was dreadful.
Well said, Stu. Well said. And let's have a look at what that does to the Fallon de Floor leaderboard. Nice to see Mickey Spillane, by the way. That's all good stuff. Right, where are they? Road to Pro, seventh. Some way off your Langley boys. I mean, top three. That's looking
I'm
pretty
still
good
happy
now.
With that. We need to have a rego. Because we should have won it.
You need to have another go. The mustard team's still below. I still took it with the wrong foot. And now we're already working on our
have
dizzy,
a right one,
dizzy pad. It's better than my left. We still haven't got a dizzy penalties replacement for next season. So watch this space. We're working on it. And if you're already feeling desperate to get involved, then simply register your interest with an email to sports@mustardtv.co.uk. So it's the last trip for Norwich City's away fans this season, coming up on Saturday. Elland Road, no less. And bear in mind, City will head there unbeaten in their last one away game. That's a good run, given the rest of this season on the road. As for Leeds, only a win will do if their campaign isn't to be remembered by the mother of all capitulations. suppose the irony is Leeds have actually done better than anyone expected at the start of the season. Yeah, could well end in massive disappointment if they don't make the top six.
And I think they will be disappointed because they had it in their own hands, haven't they, for a good period of time. So, yeah, they'll be disappointed.
Quite a thin squad. Monk's done very well to have them boxing at this bit of the league.
Yeah, I mean, they'll be desperate to keep him as well. I mean, he talks about him coming to Norwich. They've got to keep him and try and build a squad around the manager there. So
only he hasn't got a contract for next season, which is an interesting situation, isn't it?
Is that due to him or is that due to the football club?
I'm not sure yet, but it may have got to the point where it is due to him. I mean, as Sam Walden mentioned,
he might have already agreed a deal somewhere else.
He might have done. Who knows? But and it's interesting that maybe towards the end of the season, where we're getting to the point where people don't know what's going to happen next year, that uncertainty could be one of the things that's unhinging their playoff bid, in a way.
Potentially, but any manager worth their salt is always pretty good at ensuring that players are focused on the task in hand.
We like to speculate, though, Stu. We like to speculate. And as Sam Walden, as Sam Walden mentioned, I mean, he's done well to last a whole year at Leeds because it has been turmoil there, and he's just got it clicked. And he recruited well, haven't they? They've got some good youngsters coming through, but he has brought some good players in and managed what he's got. Chris Wood, it's really stepped up a level.
Yeah, and I think you're right. I think that's what they've probably overachieved this season. Yeah. So I think that they were probably looking a bit more longer term at Gary Monk. So I'd be surprised to see him leave. They'll want to keep him, I've no doubt about that. It's whether he wants to move on for another challenge. And if you get approached by a Norwich with the quality they do still have, and well, may or may not have at the start of the season, I think it'd be a really nice fit.
That and security, which you're probably never going to get at Leeds, regardless of anything. City will have a big say in their season, anyway, on Saturday. Now, Newcastle's promotion party. Let's have a look at the fixtures, shall we, for the weekend. Newcastle's promotion party kicks things off in Cardiff on Friday night before Saturday's action sees big games at the bottom for Birmingham and Blackburn. There is a West London derby at Craven Cottage, while Wednesday head to Portman Road. It promises to be pretty tense at Loftus Road, while Wigan have a tall order to avoid confirming their swift return to League One at the Medeski. Friday Sports Extra will have all the top lines from City's pre-match press conference. You'll also be able to catch those on our YouTube channel, along with my videos from Elland Road. So if you see me about with a camera, come and say hello. Why not? Now, I guess we get into who you would pick, Stuart, if you were in the dugout for Norwich City on Saturday. It's a curious debate because where do you go? Youth, experience, whatcha?
Well, I think there's got to be a sort of balance. Alan Irvine said on a few occasions that you go with players and you don't want to put them in a situation where you could actually have a detrimental effect on their confidence or their career. So I think the fact we played really well defensively against Brighton, it's the best I've seen us defending high balls in a long, long time. So I think a bit of consistency there. I like the poise that Graham Dorans brings to the midfield. I was toying with the idea of going with a more combative figure in Tetty, but I like Dorans and I like the way we play when he's in the team. And I think Jacob and Josh have both had great seasons. So that's the part of the team where I'm thinking, yeah, let's give youth a bit of a chance, and you can take Pritchard out of the team.
The interesting part for me for that squad is actually how much of that back five are going to be here next season, back four and the goalkeeper, because there's obviously Dykes ain't going to be here. Wilson come with Pinto. Bennett's been talked about as if he should leave. Russell Martin's been talked about as if he should leave. Ruddy's been talked about as if he should leave. So, I mean, that's your back four gone.
Well, they've got options in terms of John Ruddy and Ryan Bennett, so I guess they're two big decisions we'll be looking out for as soon as the season ends, how that plays out. It'd be nice to see Josh and Jacob play together again. It didn't work at Barnsley.
And actually, talking about the new identity and the style of play, I'm hoping it's being played with a bit more width. And if that's the case, then that should suit them down to the ground.
Well, Huddersfield played like that. I mean, that has to be the temporal eight we looked at. And they did play with a lot of width and almost a forward three at times.
Yeah, so I'll expect to see a similar thing here. And that could suit a lot of the players we've got. I still would like to see a classic 4-4-2 with a couple of centre-forwards.
We won't get that, I don't think. I did want to touch on Alan Irvine. We didn't get a chance to earlier in the show. I mean, is he deserving of credit here? Because he's come in, Alex Pritchard's gone straight into the side. He's started with him every game. The only time he's really had to bring him off was when Mitchell Dykes got sent off, and he was kind of left with no other way out. And defensively, they have looked more solid, obviously, given what level the opposition are at in terms of their season.
I think the key thing with Alan, firstly, as a human being, as a man, he's a very, very nice guy. He's very, very honest, very frank, which, as a journalist, you always like. But I think the key thing for me is there was loads of times this season where Alex Neil was, it was as if he was overthinking his team, Whereas I think Alan Irvine's gone in and he's just picking the best players for the game.
And he's been freer, hasn't he?
Well, it's a really interesting point because actually Alan Irvine was brought in to kind of help and guide, not guide Alex Neil, but give him the support and with all of his experience in that. And it appears to me Alex Neil didn't listen to any of that because as soon as Alex Neil's gone, Alan Irvine's done what he wanted to do, put Pritchard straight in his side. So all that time, Alan Irvine must have sat there thinking, why is Pritchard not playing?
And just on and James Maddison as well, we've seen him in the last couple of games.
Easy to when you've got nothing to play for, but he's done well. He's done one and he's deserved his chance. And
real
should prospect. Should have had it a bit earlier.
Go on then, predictions. Ellen Road, Norwich City versus Leeds.
Do you know what? I think I've gone for a draw for the last 10 games.
You like so the
I'm going to go for a one each.
You love the draw, this one.
I just think there's too much riding on the game for Leeds.
We tense, weren't it?
Yeah, I think there's a lot riding on it. So and Leeds win 2-0.
Oh, I saved the best for last, eh, Stuart? We are done
and
for
you,
tonight.
Michael?
Oh, it'll be a tight one. We're done for tonight. Definitely be a good result. If you missed any of the show, don't worry. It's all waiting for you on YouTube because we got through it, as well as being repeated regularly over the coming days on Mustard. We're back live next week and back at our usual time of 7 p.m. So we'll see you then. But for now, a big thank you to Darren Eadie and Stuart Hodge here in the studio, as well as to our callers, commenters, tweeters, and of course, a big thank you to your good selves for watching. This has been The Pinken Show. Until next time, here's to Norwich City starving their feeder club just one more time. Good night.